Okay, so last class we started talking about, last week we started talking about classes. Just as an FYI, I've been working on those short little videos. I hopefully you guys find those useful. So I've got like in this one, come down here, the whole process of creating a class. I also did one for multidimensional arrays. And for the C++ constructors, creating an object I don't think has been done yet. I've created it, I just haven't had a chance to edit and post that video. So we're working on doing that stuff. So if you need to go back and look at something, I was trying to get caught up, and I got partially caught up yesterday. But there's still more to be done, so I'll be busy this weekend doing some of these things. A big part of that is that, and one of the things that we'll be talking about in today, is that working with classes are and objects are a little bit different than what we're used to. We are very used to what's known as a procedural programming process. And that is... we do step one, we do step two, and we might have some if statements, we might have some loops and things like that. But we think about everything as far as an action that's occurring. When we start dealing with classes, we are moving away from thinking about things that are actions that occur, and instead try to think about data and what do we do to that data. So it requires a slight shift in thought process. It's not as difficult as some people make it out to be, but it does require that shift. Almost everyone that I know, unless they had years and years and years and years of procedural programming experience, unless you had that, everyone I know has been able to make a shift from procedural programming, which is a strong foundation to be able to do object-oriented programming, and then go into object-oriented programming, because you have to still understand how things like decision statements work and how things like loops work and stuff like that. So we'll be talking about some of that a little bit later today. Today should be a little bit on the short side, comparatively speaking, which would be nice because I believe there's no classes tomorrow, so give you all a little bit of a break. I know for some of you this is like your last class of the day, so that should help too. But give you guys kind of a head start on holiday week and whatnot. Some things we want to look at today though are some things that you can do in C++ to help from a programming perspective and programming side. So some of these are going to be specific to C++, the first couple ones. The last thing we're going to talk about thinking in objects, that's going to be kind of a general object-oriented methodology, if you would. So let's first talk about some of the things that you can do in C++ to help make for better object-oriented programming. Okay. So the first part here that we're going to look at is going to be preventing multiple class definitions. And what happens is it is not uncommon, especially as your project grows in size, that you are going to reference the same header file multiple times. This could be because you reference a header class in your main file where you have your main function. And then it's that header file is also referenced inside of another file that you import in. And so you have this header file that's being defined multiple times. Now you would think like, oh, wait a second, the compiler should know that this is the same file and just ignore it, right? Unfortunately, that's not always the case. This can have some problems. So I'm going to show you two different ways to prevent your compiler from running into that. Now, part of this is going back to the fact that C is an older language, C++ was built on. And because of that, there are some things that were done because machines weren't as powerful back when this started. So you need to reference that and think about that as a reason why. And that's the reason why this might be an issue in C++, but not in C# or in Java or some of those other languages that are out there. So let's look at the first way we can do that. And the first way is this is the two ways are both handled only from a compiler perspective. So we can, when we go and run a program, remember we take our source code that we write and we go through a process called compiling. That's going to convert into code that the machine can execute and run. That code is going to go, we're going to go through several steps to get from the source code to that compiled code that your machine can run. You're going to go through a compiling process where you compile each of the individual files into object code. You'll go through a linking process that will go through and join the files together into one executable or into an executable in a series of libraries like a DLL. And then from there, you will have your working file that you can then, after it's linked together, go out and run. So what we're going to work on is compiler directives that are going to affect whether something is going to check to see if something's already compiled or if something's already linked. And those are the big things that we're going to focus on. So what's going to happen is we can use a define statement. And this is going to be used to determine if a variable's been set. Now, we're not setting a value. We're just saying, hey, here's a special compiler variable, and is it defined? If it is defined, then we can do one set of operations. If it's not defined, we'll do a different set of operations. And so the key one that I want to look at is if it's not defined. And this is a special command called ifndef. So if not defined. And a standard practice is we'll put this all in capital letters, like you might see here on the screen, and we'll say circle underscore H. And so it's looking to say, hey, have we gone out and created a defined compiler variable called circle underscore H? If we've not, then let's keep going through a process. If we have, we're good, because this is ifndef, so if not defined, then what we're going to do is we're going to simply ignore the rest of this block of code until we get to an ifndef or function derivative. So if we're not defined, the first thing we're going to do is we say, okay, since we're not defined, we need to go ahead and define this so we don't go and define it again. And you can see here, we just define that the variable exists. We do not give it a value that's not important. Remember, this is compiler directive. This does not have any effect on our code at all. Then if you notice, it's the rest of our header file, just as we had seen this before. Okay, so here we have the if not defined, we define it, and then we put our regular header file. All the way at the end, we have the end if statement. So if you don't have the end if, this will not compile because the compiler directive is incomplete and it will throw an error because it doesn't understand it. So very much like a syntax error, so you have to remember both of those things. This is standard C++ code. This is something that is used all over the place, and as part of the standard, every compiler understands it. Now, some people said, well, wait a second, this is, you know, a lot of steps, unnecessary steps. So there is a non-standard method, but it is also very widely accepted. So you might say, well, how is it non-standard if it's widely accepted? So there are standards in C++. There are standards in a lot of things in computers. And you'll see things like, oh, this is SQL. You know, this is ANSI SQL. And, well, how is that different than a regular SQL? ANSI SQL is everyone got together, they agreed upon this is how all these data types are going to work, and this is how big they are, and this is what the commands are going to do. And everyone that uses this standard says that if I take this and I go from MySQL to SQL Server to Oracle to whatever, it should all work exactly the same. Okay? And that's what a standard does. So the ifndef, the define, the ifdef, the ndef, those are all standards. And those are going to work no matter what compiler, as long as the compiler is a standards compliant compiler. And there are different standards, something to keep in mind. There are different standards. And a lot of times you'll see it as something like, you know, C++ 92, which is the standard that came out in 92. And then there might be an updated one that comes out a few years later. So you got to make sure that's the right component. Okay? So if something is standards compliant, it says that I'm going to follow all of these standards. Now, widely used means that a lot of compilers have this available. But because it's not in the official standard, they do not have to support it. And they can still say that they are standards compliant. Now, this is actually the way that that Visual Studio will do it for you automatically. It's called Pragma Once. So when I went in here, and if you remember when I created a class in Visual Studio, I went over to my solution window, and said right-click, add, and said class, and I typed in a class name. It actually added the Pragma Once for me. And Pragma Once is just a little bit simpler because instead of three lines, it's one line. And it keeps track internally because computers are faster, because we have more resources, because we can do more things. It goes in and says, here you go. This is a little tool to make your life as a developer easier. So you just kind of have to know, okay, what system I'm working with, who's working on it and with it, who's making it better, those types of things. If those things are working, then you can use this. If you're going to switch to another one, and I have not had a chance to check, to be honest with you, for example, like with the online compiler that I've recommended that some people be able to use, I don't know for a fact if they support Pragma Once or if you need to use the ifndef methodology. But there are those two. If Pragma Once does not work, then the ifndef will. I don't think they can be used at the same time. That's going to cause other issues. So I would focus, if you would, on just picking one methodology. If you're using Visual Studio, like most of you are, Pragma Once is done for you automatically, which is really nice. So just kind of keep that in mind as you're working through the process. Okay. Any questions on that, on what like a standards compliance is, or on the ifndef or Pragma Once? If you don't have any questions, we've got the little thumbs up. We can do that. I got one thumbs up. Two, three. Okay, sweet. I love the fact that they go down automatically so you don't forget to put it down yourself. I think that's cool. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about instance and static members. Okay. Everything that we've looked at so far is what's known as an instance member. And what that basically means is every time we create an instance of a class, that's an object. So every time we create an object, every variable that we've defined for it has been a specific member of that object. And that is going to be independent. It does not matter based upon other objects. Okay? So if we come back here to our code, we have a private double radius as an example. I could go in here and specify another set of double that would be like X, Y, and Z. That would give me the ability to specify where the circle is going to be in a three-dimensional plane, right? And so because my radius of one circle is independent of my radius of every other circle, therefore, I don't have to worry about where I'm located. I don't have to worry about having my radius affect another object or my location coordinates affect other objects. Okay, so every time I create that object, I make a separate duplicated copy of that. And anytime I have something that I need to ensure is going to be dependent upon this instance and this instance alone, I will use an instance variable. Okay. But what if I wanted to use a static variable, which means that this data is shared amongst all of my objects? Okay. If I'm going to have something that is shared data between all of my objects, I can do this easily with a static variable. And the book gives a kind of a good example, and believe it or not, behind the scenes, where you don't see it, your compiler does this actual very option or behavior. So what I want to do is I want to keep track of the count of circles that we have. So I might say something like int count of circles. You might say, well, okay, but how does one circle know about the other? And that's where we're going to create and use a static keyword. By specifying it static, this is similar to when we use a static variable in a function, but it's also slightly different. Instead of a function, we just remembered what that value was. When it's inside of a class, we remember what that value is. We predefine it to be equal to zero, but it is able to be shared amongst all instances. What's nice about this is as a static variable, any method can access it, but they will all access the exact same value. Now, in comparison, I can create a static method. And it's going to be very similar. So I'm going to come right here and say static int get count of circles. When a method is static, I can only use static variables, and I can only use or variables that are specific to that function. So you might say, well, that's kind of limiting. Why would I want that? Well, there's a couple reasons why I might want to use a static method. First off, to access a static variable, if all I'm doing is use a static variable, I might want to use a static method. Remember, we said that when we create an instance or an object of a class, we come in and create its own set of functions, its own set of variables, everything, and we create a copy of that. So if I have a circle, I've got a copy of all my functions, all my instance variables, all this stuff. Now, if I create another object, I've got another set of copies. So this is all duplicated. If all I'm doing is getting access to a static variable, well, I might create a static class, and that instance is just like with my static variable. My static method is shared amongst all of them. And this makes it for a little bit more efficient memory usage, especially if I were to have tons and tons of these. So if I've only got one circle, there's no difference. If I got two circles, it's a small difference. If I have 10,000 circles, now it's starting to add up a little bit. So why not make everything static? Well, remember, a static method only access other static members. And if everything is static, then everything is being used the same, and that's going to cause a problem. Okay, so static has some specific needs or uses in something like this. Now, sometimes we will have a class that only has static methods. You might go, well, that's kind of crazy. Why would I do that? And there's a lot of different reasons we would actually want to do this. And when you look at some other classes in the future, things like 2.10, where we talk about data structures, or 4.60, we talk about algorithms, you'll see some of these. But a lot of times they happen to focus on things like, I need to do a conversion, and I need to do a conversion of integers into doubles or integers into strings. And so I might create a conversion class. And I'm not really designed to hold data, but I just want to be able to convert data. And so I'll create like a little library of functionality using static methods. And instead of accessing local variables, I'll say you need to pass that data into me. So that's an instance, for example, where I would do something like that. I could also have it if I use something that's known as a factory. And a factory is a programming methodology that which helps us to create objects. So we're not going to get into that right now. That's kind of a little bit more of an intermediate type of topic. But you do find it's used quite a bit, especially in Java, having singletons and having factories to create objects from other objects in the ways that they process it. So just something to kind of keep in mind going in the background as far as that goes. Okay, so I've got my static method. I'm going to go ahead and open up my circle class. Let's see here. And so I'm going to say static void, static int get count of circles, return count of circles. Why is it not liking that? Whoa. I didn't put that. Okay. So that's just a kind of example where we can do that. Inside of our constructors, right here we have our circle. And I set my radius. I might do count of circles plus plus. What does that do? Well, that takes and increments my counter. So every time I create a new circle, I increment that value. And so that's just a kind of a really common, simple way that I would reference that in order to get it to work. Okay. So that's just a one of those type of methodologies that we could wind up using in order to reference and build these static methods and use these static functions. If we come back here. Okay, so you just kind of see how those are working. Okay, this is something that is more important, I personally find and think, if you're working on a bigger project and you have a lot of people working on it. So I can create a function that is not going to allow any instance variables to be changed. A perfect example is if I'm trying to get the value of some function. I will want to specify that since I'm getting a value, I can't make any changes. That's pretty typical, but you might say, well, how, you know, isn't this obvious? Well, if I was a developer working on a project and I hand something off to you and you're brand new, you're right out of college, it's easy to get overwhelmed, especially on a large project. You know, when you go from files that are typically, you know, 20 to 30 lines in length to something that's hundreds of lines in length, it's very easy to get overwhelmed. And it's very easy, I hate to admit this, but to start editing in the wrong section of a file. You know, think about if you've ever started typing like a text message and you're having a couple, three chat windows going on and you send the wrong message to the wrong person. It's an easy mistake. It's nothing's going to be too bad with it usually, but it's something that can happen. So if I were to go and create the header files and say, hey, I'm going to get you started so you can work with this, I can go in and set a const keyword. And that's just going to let C++ know that, hey, these values cannot change inside of the function. Okay. So it's just a real quick, easy way to make sure that, look, you're not going to be changing these values. If you see a value that gets changed, there's a problem. Now, is this going to work all the time? Not necessarily. For example, I might need to keep track of how many times someone goes in to access an account number, because I might use that as part of an anti-fraud process. I need to know how many times people are trying to access account numbers. That doesn't seem right. So I might have a little counter in there. I might have other reasons for not wanting to do this. So this is why it's not standard. You have to specify it. But there are legitimate reasons to use this as well. And so I just want to kind of keep you in mind and be aware of that. It's in more detail. You can find it in the book. I forgot to put the book number, so pardon me while I look that up for you real quick. $390 in the book, just as an FYI. Okay, so that's where that is. So, okay. What's the next thing I want to work on? Okay, here we go. Okay. The last thing I want to talk about was, and I kind of alluded to this earlier today, was the what we call thinking in objects. So how do we start thinking about it and making this mental shift from procedural programming into object-oriented programming, or sometimes you'll see it referred to as OOP, O-O-P. So the big thing is, instead of looking at the function, which is things that are going to occur, so procedural programming, or sometimes referred to as functional programming, is all about performing actions. I start my program and I start going down this procedural list of things I need to do. It might have conditions, it might have loops, but I'm following this list. With object-oriented programming, I start thinking about what data am I going to be referencing and using. So if you think back to the class circle that we defined earlier, we specified that we needed a radius. That was a important thing. So instead of taking a radius, a get area function, and then assigning or passing data to it, we created a circle class that would hold a radius. And then we could go in and specify and say, okay, now get the area of this object. In something so simple, it makes more sense to use a simple function in procedural programming, but it allows us to get a lot more complicated at the same time. So if we go in just as a perfect example, if I'm thinking about my circle probably has as a minimum so x and y coordinate values on a Cartesian plane. And so now I'm not just dealing with a circle that has a radius. That's simple. But now I can expand this and be more complete. Think about where is it located? And I can, depending upon my usage, I can add additional features and functionalities, like is my circle shaded or is it hollow or is it, line art? Is it part of a chart? Is it, those types of things that go with it? Do I want the ability to only draw part of a circle by passing in the radians of where it's valid from, so I can make a half circle, quarter circle, or something like that. I could start to really expand upon the complexity of something as simple as a circle, because I'm thinking of it as an object, and from there I can make a lot more effective decisions. And that's what I want to look at, is how do I do stuff like that? Because that's going to have a big impact on what I can do with it. If I've got to kind of try to keep track of all this data that's related but dissimilar, it becomes very, very complicated to process and control all this. If I can put it into an object and treat it as one separate entity, and I've got another one, this is another separate entity, and then I can create methods based upon what they need to do or would be doing, that's a real important thing. That really, really helps me. When I look at things that are physical objects, this is really, really simple, because I can look at a physical object and I can start to make assumptions about what sets of properties my program is going to need to know about it. So if I'm looking at cars, and I'm trying to build an application for managing a fleet of cars, maybe for like a rental company or something like that. I can start looking and saying, okay, I'm going to have a category, and my category is going to be things like compact and subcompact and sedan and SUV and minivan and stuff like that. I'm going to start looking at having properties like how many passengers can I hold, or how much cargo space can I hold, or what's my fuel rating and stuff like that. Anything that I might need if I'm building an application to manage and control my rental car fleet. Okay, I'm going to need to know about certain properties like my VIN number and other things, if it's been checked out, what my current checkout schedule is, etc. And sometimes I'm going to get more complicated data. The schedule of checkout is a perfect example of that. And that's where I could actually have an object within an object. So I could have, for example, I want to know who's, I want to be able to keep track of everyone who's ever rented this particular car. And I can go in and say, okay, here's a person, there's a person, here's a person. And they had it between this date and this date, and person B had between that date and that date, and I can keep track of all this information. Each time they reserve the car, it has its own collection of information. Not only what car was reserved and checked out, but from the starting and ending dates, what was the status, if you would, when it came back, did it have any extra dings and dents that weren't there when I started? Those types of things that might be relevant to running and managing this rental car fleet. I probably don't care about every property. In fact, 99 times out of 100, I'm not going to care about every possible property. So, for example, my rental car fleet probably doesn't care about how many horsepower it's going to be, or what its top speed is going to be, or any of those types of things. Because those aren't things that you typically don't look at when you're referencing a rental car agreement. Now, if I had, there are some places that do like exotic cars that you can rent. So if I know down in Miami, there's a couple of exotic rental cars. And if I wanted to go and go down there, I could rent a Ferrari, or I could rent a Lamborghini, or something like that. They don't have, I think the cheapest standard car they have is like BMWs and Mustang GTs and stuff like that. They don't have standard cars. You don't go there to get your, you know, generic Nissan or generic Toyota or Chevy or whatever. You go there specifically for these luxury cars. In cases like that, they might care about things like what's their maximum speed and how many horsepower, because that's something that the person who's going to go rent the car, they're going to be looking at. They want that fancy muscle car. They want that fancy sports car or whatever when they're going out and doing the things that they're doing down on Miami Beach. I'm sure there's other rental agencies and some other kind of high profile types of cities where that's a popular thing. So like I said, you're not always going to need it, but you may. And so it just kind of depends upon what your application is doing and why it's doing it, as to if you need to bother to put in every possible property. And other things, they just don't mind, you know, don't matter. We've talked about having a class for a student, and I might keep track of things like, you know, your date of birth and your first name and last name and your student number and stuff like that. But on the other side, there's things that as a student, I probably don't need to know about you. And if you wanted to know all this information about me, I would start to, you know, from a privacy perspective, I would start to be a little concerned, you know, if you start asking me what my blood type was, or, you know, if you needed to know all types of data that doesn't pertain to me being a student. You know, my blood type should have zero impact on what type of student I'm going to be. It shouldn't matter if I have brown hair or blonde hair or red hair or no hair. You know, that shouldn't matter. So in cases like that, there are things that, you know, in almost every case, there's always going to be some sort of property that is not relevant that we don't have to worry about, don't have to think about. So figuring out what types of data you're going to use, what types of data you're going to need, and if that data can be grouped together into its own class. In fact, there's a whole separate instance of that, and it's known as an aggregation relationship, or a HAZA relationship. The HAZA is where one object has another object as part of its data. Another example, and one I listed in the notes that you can find online, would be things like if you're a student, a major. And the major that you declare is very important, because it might have things like, what types of classes do you have to have in order to graduate? Well, I could then reference that information and say, oh, okay, I need these classes. I can look at your transcript and go, oh, you've had, and then match up and go, these are the missing classes that you need to take. So those types of things become real important, real relevant to how you're going to be building your objects. When we look at object-oriented programming in more detail in future classes, you're going to find a lot more. You're going to have HAZA relationships, ISA relationships, parent-child type relationships, all those types of things. We're keeping this pretty simple at this point, because it's always good to start simple and then build up. But a couple of guidelines that you do want to be mindful of when you're building out your classes and things like that. And these are all listed in a book. These are just like little snippets and notes. You can read in the book to find some more specific, a little bit more detailed answers. But things like cohesion. And your cohesion is your class should cover a single type of entity. So if I'm building an application for a school, I'm going to have a student class. I'm going to have an instructor class. I'm not going to have a generic person class that tries to merge students and instructors together. We're different. We have different behaviors that are going to be performed. We're going to have different properties that define us. We need to be separate. Even though there is some crossover, we should not try to be forced into one class. Consistency, and this is more about following standard naming guidelines and programming styles and conventions and stuff like that. Encapsulation. So remember we said, okay, very early on, we started with our data being public, and then we said, okay, this is a problem, so we're going to do encapsulation. Encapsulation says all of our data members are private, and then we use things like getters and setters to access them. And the big deal about that is the fact that it lets us make changes to the way we store data and the way we have the data stored without having to let everyone know how we're doing it. We just still let them have access to those getters and setters, and things work fine. If you follow those previous three things, clarity should be easy and should just follow naturally. And a big deal about this is because if we're using our proper naming conventions, we will be generating what's sometimes referred to as self-commenting code. And self-commenting code just means that if I look at a function name or a method name in case of object-oriented programming, I should clearly and easily be able to tell what this function is doing. So that's a big thing in clarity. I shouldn't have to write out three pages of comments. Now, that doesn't mean I'm not going to write comments. And don't. A lot of times people go, oh, I wrote really good comment, you know, self-commenting code. That's cool, but we still need to comment stuff. We still need to know how things are going to work. Completeness, and this is just making sure that if we're going to write a class, especially if it's going to be for a publicly accessible library that other people are going to reference, that it needs to be complete. I provide an example here. It's not in the book. It's only here. Is if I create a class for a dice, I might go, oh, well, if I'm playing craps or if I'm playing Yahtzee or if I'm playing, you know, Monopoly, I've got a six-sided dice and it doesn't, there's nothing special about them. All those dice are the same. They have numbers 1 through 6. They're all the same color. Everything's good. Well, but if I'm writing a publicly accessible class, that's not necessarily going to be the case because in some cases I might have a 20-sided die. Or my wife and my kids, they were playing, I think it was Star Wars Monopoly the other day. And in that case, they have a light-sided die and they have a dark-sided die. And depending upon who your character is and what your, their equivalent to treasure chest or whatever in the Star Wars Monopoly is, sometimes they'll tell you use this die or use that die or use this die and do this modifier or that die. And so there's certain things that just happen naturally that they're using differently. So we would, to be complete, need to specify if it's got a color associated with it, ask how many sides are associated with it. I might have a different die altogether. I might have a die that uses letters instead of numbers. I've seen that as well. Boggle, if you think about that game, is a good example where you're using letters instead of numbers. And that makes for some interesting changes and stuff. So just how things like that get placed.
I've played an RPG
really
with
make an effect on how complete something is. And then we talked a little bit today about instance versus static and variable method. If it's dependent upon that specific instance of that object, then it's an instance level variable. And it should be treated as such. If the data is shared amongst all of my instances, then it's a static method or variable, and we can do it that way. So those are just some basic guidelines that kind of get you started with. Like I said, in future classes, that becomes more detailed as we dive deeper into the subject. So don't think that you say, oh, this is everything I need to know, but this is definitely a good start to be working on that type of idea or project. Any questions that you might have so far? Okay, I got a thumbs up. I'm assuming this is no. Excellent. Okay, so just as an FYI, I believe I have graded everything and that has been turned into this class. If you see something that does not have a grade, please let me know. I do want to make sure I'm not missing anything for you guys. So feel free to give me an email. You guys can look at it. Basically, everything that's been turned in has been good. I've been very pleased with it. As far as that goes, I know some of you guys have been coming to office hours or asked to meet me outside of office hours because of scheduling conflicts. And I've tried to be flexible with that. And so you guys have been coming in and asking for help and getting the help when you need. I appreciate that. That's great. I'm always happy to meet with you guys and help out as far as that goes. But make sure you've got everything in. Make sure that I've graded everything that is in, please. And then we can kind of go from there. You should have a new assignment up. It's not done yet. I am working on that. Once that's done, we will determine the next assignment. We'll be kind of building off of the idea of our two-dimensional assignment where we figured out distances and using our classes. So it's going to be a little bit different. I'm trying to make sure I write that up in a way that's easy enough to understand and things like that. So just kind of be mindful of that. I'm probably going to have to give you guys some sample files to start with, and that's okay. Just so we start on a nice basis, but then we can see what's going to go from there. So it will probably not be ready until tomorrow, but you'll have plenty of time to work on it and stuff, so don't worry about that. All right, if there's no other questions, then I am actually done for the week. We got, like I said, we'd probably be done a little bit early today, and we are. If I'll stay around if you guys need me to answer any questions that you guys have about assignments or anything else. Otherwise, please have a good and safe weekend. Everyone, please be safe. I know with all this craziness going on, it's a little tough and everything that's happening with it. But do the best you can to stay safe. I know I'm doing my best, and hopefully we'll get a chance to see you all next semester with us. So until then, have a good weekend.